Mother's Day is known mostly as a time of brunches, gifts, cards, and general outpouring of love and appreciation. But the holiday has more somber roots. It was founded for mourning women to remember fallen soldiers and work for peace. When the holiday went commercial, its greatest champion, Anna Jarvis, gave everything to fight it, dying penniless and broken in a sanitarium in a state of dementia. She could have profited from it, but she rallied against it. Those who did and cost her everything, financially and physically. We can attest to the fact, can't we, that today it has become very, very commercialized. Very. It commercialized everything anymore. Could we have the men to stand? Could we have all the men to stand? Bill Lawson, would you lead us in prayer and all the men pray with you for our mothers and our grandmothers? We have grandmothers invested in this just as much as we do mothers. You know, you have heard it said, and I'm sure you said it many times yourself, we don't know how the other half lives. You don't realize how many grandmothers, are involved in taking care of their grandchildren, not always by choice. They love them, but they're accepting the responsibility of them, and some are much older than the days they really could take care of. A young man wanted to get his wife something for their first anniversary, so he bought her a cell phone. He explained all the features to her. The next day, she went shopping. Her phone rang, and it was her husband. "How do you like your phone?" "I love it. How'd you know I was at Walmart?" What color was her hair, do you think? Ron got it real quick. Sister Garman, I'd like to ask you to stand. She is our church mother. She's our first lady. I'd like to ask you, did your clothing designer snub you like they did Melania? They didn't? Okay. I'd like to would you like to say something? I'm sorry, go ahead.
No.
Oh, you don't? Okay. The oldest mother. And we have two that are the same age, however, one's older than the other, if that makes sense. I'd like for you to stand, if you would, please. Oh, I forgot. Oh, yeah. I forgot about Sister Marie. You got it. Otherwise, they were all going to fall. They were not able to choose that person until the woman gave a very touching speech. She said she would voluntarily let go of the rope because as a woman, she was used to giving up everything for her husband and kids and was always making sacrifices with little return. As soon as she finished her speech, all the men started clapping. That's women for you. That's women. And that's men for you, too. God's masterpiece is mother. God took the fragrance of a flower, the majesty of a tree, the gentleness of morning dew, the calm of a quiet sea, the beauty of the twilight hour, the soul of a starry night, the laughter of the rippling brook, the grace of a bird in flight. Then God fashioned from these things a creation like no other. And when his masterpiece was through, he called it simply, can we all say it together, what he called it?
Mother.
Can we say it again?
Mother.
If you have your mother or grandmother with you today, spend time with her. Or call them if they're not with you. For most mothers, grandmothers, time with you is what they want most of all. Turn off your cell phone so they can have your undivided attention.
Oh, that you're here this morning. I was thinking about a gentleman by the name of Methuselah. He must have thought about it as he was celebrating his 960th birthday. He probably thought, man, I'm going to live forever. But on big 969, he went to be with the Lord. So at some point in time, it is appointed unto man to die. So that's all part of it. But I think Thelma, brother, someone said this morning that the song that we just sung, the old song, goes way, way back. One day, that will be. And she said that she couldn't hardly wait for that day. And you probably didn't hear my response, but I said, just hang on a little bit longer, and because we're all getting ready to leave this place.
Amen.
With all my heart, that the Lord is coming, and he's coming very, very soon. Want to just take a moment? Y'all know I'm not on rhetoric, but this is not rhetoric. I'd like to give honor to Bishop Lawson this morning and thank him publicly for standing in for me last Sunday morning. Encouraging to you, I listened to the entire message and it encouraged me. And so, Bishop, thank you.
Yes.
The fire's still there, man. There may be some white stuff on top, but the fire's still
there.
And if I start speaking in Spanish this morning, just ignore me. But we did have a blessed weekend. And I can assure you, it was not a sabbatical, it was not a vacation. I guess I wouldn't work so hard. It just, I'll tell you something very humorously, and we'll give great attention to our moms this morning. I think it was Sunday night, and the house was filled, people were excited, and I left, no sure, on the way back home, we got home about something before 1 o'clock Monday morning. I was thinking about this beautiful congregation, but how so many of us are blessed with age, and probably 80% of that congregation is 40 and down under that age. And I mean, I preached for 45 minutes to an hour, just as hard as I could go. I just quit, just stopped, because it just, and so anyway, I gave the invitation, must have been 100 people come up line across, and I prayed for many of them. And then I thought it was over. We started at 6 o'clock Sunday evening. Now, this is the truth. And it was Friday night, Saturday afternoon, Sunday morning, Sunday night. And I thought, well, they're going to dismiss. But lo and behold, those young people took off marching. And they just marched. And they marched. And I looked at my wife and said, I better act like I'm in it anyway. So I got up and I marched a couple times around the house with them. And the sister that translated for me, I was trying, everyone knows our regional bishop is retiring. His health, he's having some very severe health issues. But anyway, he's retiring. And so I was recognizing him, Sister Judy, and I was telling the people. And every time I make a statement, like I'm speaking in English, and you all know this, Andy, Sister Andy, would translate what I was saying. And so I said that the bishop and I had been friends, personal friends, close, I guess. We're probably, each of us are two of the oldest friends that either one of us have. We've been very close friends since we were 12, 13 years old. And I said, and she was interpreting, or she was translating for me, and I said, we have been the closest of friends for over 5.5 decades. Well, she was translating for me, and all across that auditorium, people were sniggering. We're saying we've been friends for 5.5 decades. I looked over at Annie and I said, Annie, did I say something wrong? She said, no, Bishop, I said something wrong. I said, you did? She said, yeah. I said that you and Bishop Lawson have been the closest of friends for over 50 decades. So anyway, God bless you. God bless the mothers this morning. It's this is an honorable day for you and Millie. Wonderful things have already been said about you, and you can't, I don't know if you can really imagine what a delight you are to we as the male factors. My wife, I've been thinking about her for a couple of things about her all the time, and I was thinking about how gracious she's been for 47 years. She stood by me, and Alan Davis used to say, his wife traveled all over the country, washed my old dirty socks, raised my kids, and all these things. But my wife is, she is certainly a great mom. She's my first lady, and she's my dearest friend, and I want to honor her this morning just for her faithfulness to the Lord, but her faithfulness to me in traveling and being in as many places and areas as we have been over the years. I've heard some stories that were not stories, they were nightmares. Dear men of God that, you know, started out and maybe their wives and the mother of their children was not as committed as they could have been. And it caused a lot of difficulty and strains on the marriage. But my wife has, she's never done anything. I've said this before, in 47 years of full-time ministry, I don't remember one time that she's ever embarrassed me. Not one time, that's the truth. I don't remember one time in 47 years that I even had a thought, well, I wish she wasn't my wife, or I wish I had married someone else. So I pay honor, high tribute to my lovely wife this morning. And all of you moms, we just want to give you a great big praise offering. Let's just give all our moms a great big praise. Little Juju this morning, and I said, Happy Mother's Day, Juju, to you in about 30 years. Praise the Lord. Let me just share something a little humorous with you that I come across this week. As we honor our mothers today, and these were answers that were given by second grade school children. The question was asked to these second graders, why did God make mothers? Their response was, she's the only one who knows where the Scotch tape is. They said, mostly to clean the house. To help us out there when we were getting born. Not that one, rather, too, surely. And then the question was asked of them, how did God make mothers? He used dirt, just like for the rest of us. He used magic plus superpowers and a lot of stirring. God made my mom just like he made me. He just used bigger parts. And then the question was asked to these second graders, what ingredients are mothers made of? Their response was, God makes mothers out of clouds and angel hair and everything nice in the world and one dab of mean. And the response was, they had to get their start from men's bones. Then they mostly use string, I think. And the last one, what did mom need to know about dad before she married him? She needed to know his last name. She had to know his background. Like, is he a crook? Does he get drunk on beer? Does he make at least $800 a year? And did he say no to drugs and yes to chores? We honor you today, mothers. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Turn your Bibles for a few moments, if you would, this morning, to Exodus chapter 20. I want to begin the message this morning, reading from two parts of the Bible, the Old and the New. First, I want to read Exodus chapter 20 and verse 12. And then I want to read Ephesians chapter 6, verses 1. Through verses 3. Exodus chapter 20, verse 12. Moses writes, honor your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. Ephesians 6, 1 through 3. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother. And I'm going to kind of eliminate fathers today, because this is, we're honoring our mothers. But honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it may go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on earth. Father, in the name of Jesus, I'm so grateful for this wonderful day. This day that we pay honor and tribute to all of our mothers. This is a wonderful day, God. It's a day that I pray, Lord, that will be exalted, that our mothers will be blessed today, and that we'll give them accolades that they are certainly worthy of, God. And we honor our moms today. And I pray, Holy Spirit, that you use me this next 20 or 30 minutes, God, to speak your word. Use my vocal cords today. May I be your mouthpiece. I submit to your anointing. I trust your anointing. And I recognize that I simply cannot minister without the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And as always, God, there's one among us today that does not know Jesus Christ as Lord and as Savior. And oh God, let this be their moment in time. Speak to our hearts this morning, Lord, and simply use me, God, the way you do. And I'll be so careful to always magnify that name that is high and exalted and lifted up. For it is in the mighty name of Jesus I pray. And everyone said,
Amen.
Amen. Paul said, honor your mother. Honoring mothers today. Honor your mother, which is the first commandment with promise. First commandment with promise. I want to just use for a thought a few moments this morning from the honoring the fifth commandment, which is the first commandment with promise. The word honor is defined as value, appreciate, esteem, respect, regard favorably, to see as weighty and precious. To see as weighty and precious. A little boy forgot his lines in a Sunday school presentation. His mother was in the front row to prompt him. She gestured and formed the word silently with her lips, but it didn't seem to help. Her son's memory was simply blank. Finally, she leaned forward and whispered the cue, "I am the light of the world." The child beamed and with great feeling and a loud, clear voice said, "My mother is the light of the world." God wants us to give honor where honor is due. I believe that. And I believe when we honor our mothers, not just today, this is a day that's been designed and designated nationally, and I don't know how many other places around the world, but in our country, this is a day that has been designated to pay honor and great tribute to our mothers. But God desires that. That's the will of God, to give honor where honor is due. And I believe when we honor our mothers, I believe this with all my heart, I believe that we attract God's favor and God's blessings. When we honor our mothers, I believe that attracts the favor of God. I believe that attracts the blessings of God. The scripture says it's the first commandment with promise. The first commandment with promise. And the promise is that it may go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on the earth. I thought about this meager congregation here, 40, 50 or so people that we have that attend this church. And many in this church are well blessed with age. I mean, with that, we're all aware of that. We have multiple people that are well up in their 80s and a number that are up in their 70s and some of us are clocking you out. We're shooting right behind you here. But I thought about this scripture that it's the first commandment. Honor your mother. It's the first commandment with promise. And the promise is that it may go well with you. And that you may enjoy long life on the earth. I'm wondering if that's not the most important reason or the main reason that so many of you in this congregation have lived and enjoyed longevity of life. because that's what the scripture said. I know what the world says. I know what our society says. But the scripture says that when you honor your mother, it's the first commandment with promise. And he made the promise very clear. And the promise is that it may go well with you. How many feel like it's, well, I know some of us have some grunts and groans, but it's still well with you. You're still among the living, and you still are enjoying life. And I wonder if that could not be the main reason that many of our people have lived such long and fruitful and blessed lives. The Bible teaches us to honor our mother. In the original language, the word honor means to make heavy. In other words, we're not to take our mothers lightly. God calls us to actively give her respect and reverence. How many believe that this morning? God calls us to actively give our mothers, give her the respect and the reverence that she deserves. There is a difference between obeying and honoring. To obey means to do as one is told. To honor means to respect and love. I'm not sure that some of those times my mother was slapping me silly. I grant you, you obeyed my mom. Look at somebody and say, yeah, you would obey his mom. You, if you stayed in my mother's presence, you just obey her. And when you get that little silly notion, well, I'll just run, I can outrun her. That didn't work for me either. So, you know, there is a difference between obeying and honoring. To obey means to do as one is told. To honor means to respect and love. Yeah. It is possible to obey your mother and yet not love and respect her. This commandment is difficult today because we live in an age of disrespect. Do we not?
Yes.
We live in an age of disrespect. I've never seen so much disrespect in my life. I have never seen so much disrespect, and it has to be, it must be a learned characteristic. A three-year-old child, it's just not a natural instinct for them to swear at their mother, or to curse at their mother, or to be disobedient to their mother. It is a learned characteristic, and it oftentimes comes from the lack of discipline and the lack of love. People leave the impression with you, I love my child, I would never put my hands on my child. Well, I'd like to capitalize on that. If you really love that three-year-old, now again, you're going to put your hands on his or her little... I'm just trying to preach this. Let's go home. I get in trouble every time I preach anything about this anymore. I don't believe it's just because I was the way that, well, it's certainly the way I was raised, but it's not because I'm from an old traditionalistic background. It's because it's scripture. And that's the way moms, when they really love their children and care for their children, they embrace them, they praise them, they clap for them, they give them accolades. But when they're disobedient, and when they, especially after they have been admonished and warned, you don't do that. You don't act that way. You can't speak to me like that. But anyway, this commandment is difficult because we live in this age of disrespect. Youth is glorified, and old age is seen as something to avoid at all costs. I don't know about you, but I'm having a pretty good time getting old. Man, I tell my wife, I don't even know if she totally agrees with me. I hear people say when they get up in their 60s, well, if I could just be 40 again. And do what? Just going to just relive it again, and the next thing you know, you're going to wake up one morning and you're going to be 60-something or 70-something. So, anyway. On TV and in the movies, kids are most often portrayed as the witty heroes. And parents tend to be the pathetic, overbearing clown. It's a fact. Can I remember Al Bundy, Homer Simpson? I never did that. I always thought some of that stuff was so ridiculous. The elderly are most often viewed as senile and to be avoided if you want to have a good time. And it seems the media reflects the attitude of this culture. which is disrespect for parents and grandparents. But Paul encourages us. Paul says to young Timothy in 2 Timothy 1 and 5, I have been reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice. And I am persuaded now, Timothy, that same sincere faith is living in you. Hallelujah. Listen to me. Everyone needs to be mentored. We need to be told how to live. That's why some of you are not having a lot of trouble with your children when they're small, because you don't allow them to be mean. I preached to you 2 weeks. Let me bend just a little.
Go for it. I love it.
This is so like, I wish we had a house full of young mothers, but we don't. That's just the way it is. But I wish this, our culture, and I say this for the life of our children that are coming on. I wish our culture would understand how important it is for parents, for mothers, to really love their children. It's hard for a mother to convince me that she loves that 3 or 4 year old. I can't tell you, picking up my grandson at our South Elementary School here, I can't tell you how often that when I go there to drop him off, mostly when I go back to pick him up, at the foul language that I hear. And the ill that spews from parents and from grandparents. Cheryl and I were sitting in the car a couple of weeks ago waiting for TJ to come out of the school and for them to be dismissed. And there were two ladies sitting just across from us. And our windows were down, and their windows were down. And they were grandmothers. They weren't 21-year-old mothers. They were grandmothers. And some of the most foul language came out of their mouths. And I'm thinking, Lord, they're coming to pick up a precious little child and listen what's coming out of their mouths. And we wonder why that our culture and our world is in such disarray. We wonder why the drugs and so much paraphernalia of this world has overwhelmed and introduced itself and invaded homes, and simply folks just seem like they don't know what to do because they missed the mark early on by not truly rearing and raising the child in the fear and admonishment of the Lord Jesus. Everyone needs to be mentored. We need to be told how to live. We need to be taught about what is really important. Someone said, this is one of the most beautiful statements that I've read, and I don't know when. I don't even know who wrote this. I'd like to learn. I'd like to know who wrote this. Mothers write on the hearts of their children what the rough hand of the world cannot erase. Amen. Did you hear that? You say, Pastor, you put a lot of pressure on mothers. Well, if you have the child, take the responsibility. In Walmart yesterday, looking for a Mother's Day card for Shirley. I'll never wait till the last day to do that again. But in Walmart yesterday, while looking for it, listen to this, Karen. This is going to be repulsive to most of you, and I know this is on YouTube and whatever. But when in Walmart yesterday, looking for a Mother's Day card that would, from my heart, and would have appropriate words in it for my dear wife, my lovely wife. One card disturbed me. Actually, there was two or three in there. And I want to quote to you, and I made a note of this. It read, woman to woman, wife to wife, with a picture of two women on the front cover embracing and kissing each other on the mouth. Inside the card, it said, I never thought I would ever find a woman I could love as much as I love you. Thirty years ago, this is the most popular preaching you could preach. Actually, we didn't preach too much about it because there wasn't much of it going on. Listen, it is your responsibility, mothers. This is Mother's Day.
Yes.
This is your responsibility to teach your child the difference in male and female.
Yeah,
yeah, and I feel a little tough on that, so I better leave it alone. It's Mother's Day, and I don't want
to. Help him more.
Yeah, I just got to point. I don't care whether people like this or not.
Amen.
We have an entire generation of precious, precious children that's coming up.
Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I mean, they're precious.
Amen.
Precious are children in the sight of the Lord. The old kids' song we used to sing, Jesus loves the little children of the world.
Amen.
Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in His sight.
Yes, they are.
And the thing that concerns me is there's so much rebellion against truth.
Yes.
There's so much rebellion against the gospel, the precious living Word of God, that we are few and far apart with parents and mothers again, especially you, especially your love, things that you on your baby's heart right now, this world will not be able to erase it. No matter what comes that child's way, no matter what takes place, no matter what transpires in their lives as they grow up into maturity and adulthood, mamas, what you have written on that child's heart, this world will not be able to erase it. But you better write the right stuff. Mothers have the opportunity to hand down their faith about God. There's no confusion in heaven. There is no mother God. God's not your mama. God is our eternal Father who sits on the throne. He rules. He reigns. He is supreme. He's above all. Hallelujah. He surpasses everything. All this world, all the nations of the world, and all the governments of the world. Not Mother God, God the Father. Mothers have the opportunity to hand down their faith about God. They have a unique ability. Unique ability. God put it in you.
Yes.
Yes. The unique ability to demonstrate God's love and grace. This was a testimony of Timothy concerning his grandmother Lois and his mother Eunice. They guided Timothy. I'll tell you, by the time Timothy probably was 18 years old, there was no question, 18 months old, there was no question whether Timothy was male or female.
Amen.
Please don't anyone in this house get upset with me for preaching this today. What in the world is wrong with you?
Amen.
Our children are the ones that are going to suffer for our lack of motherhood. already are.
Yes, they are.
So if they're going to spew their venom all across this nation, I'm going to declare the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. God, maybe I do need to be an evangelist. When we're young, we need an example of sincere faith. Too often I've heard parents say that they want their children to make up their own minds about religion. They usually say that because they haven't made up their own minds. So in essence, they're making disciples of their own belief system. Gee. Their children want to believe like them unless somewhere along the way there is an intervention. If you will read 1 Samuel chapter 1, you will find within the chapter of a godly mother with the spirit of perseverance. When external circumstances look impossible, time won't allow to go into all this, but when external circumstances looked impossible, Hannah saw God. Yes. Hannah got a hold of God. Hannah was answered by God. She was touched by God. She persevered and turned the impossible into the possible and conceived Samuel. Samuel's name literally means heard by God.
Hallelujah. Praise God.
The bond between a mother and her infant child is powerful. I want to tell you, mamas, there's just something about you. There's just something about you. There's something about the way God designed you. There's just something about a mother that it cannot be found in any other area or aspect of life. There's something about a mother that is just beyond true, real comprehension. There's something about a mom's touch. Even if she's smacking you. There's something about a mother's touch.
Yes.
There's something about the way God created within the female gender, if you will. He made her so very wonderfully. He created her with such abilities to do things that we men don't have the ability to do. Let me tell you, this is a little bit humor, but just bear with me for a moment or two. There's just something about you, mothers. There's just something about inside of you that's innate. God placed that in you. When he put Mr. Adam to sleep, when he sedated Adam, everybody knows this, but when God Almighty sedated Adam and put him to sleep and went inside of his innards and pulled him out of a rib and then took that rib and made himself a woman.
Yes. Yeah.
He did something. Most men want to take credit for that. Get over yourself. That is absolutely extraordinary, to say the least. She has a touch about her that nothing else has.
Amen.
Nothing has a touch like a mother's touch.
Amen.
That little puppy that we have, oh, we all know how crazy I am about that dog. I've never had an animal I love so much in my life. I love that animal. I love that dog. She's precious to me. I think she's the prettiest dog ever lived. I think she's the most passionate, compassionate dog I know that we've ever owned, and we've owned many over the years. I love that puppy.
Yeah.
I ride her. I take her for rides 3 or 4 times a week in the car. Don't turn me in, but I let her ride across my lap. She lays her little head over on my lap, and we just ride around, and we have a good time. I take her every morning, mostly to pick TJ up, and then when I go to pick him up in the afternoon, unless she has to go again, I take the little puppy with me. I love on her. I let her lay over on my shoulder. I kiss her on the top of her head. I haven't got to the kissing part yet. I'm not there yet. My point I want to make is obviously I love that dog. And she listens to my command. She knows I do not like to hear her yell. Boy, that drives me crazy. And she won't just growl a little bit. But once she starts to growl, I told her about 3 weeks ago, I said, puppy, you don't growl until you hear me growl. A couple minutes, she started growling again. I said, did you hear me growl? She's outside and she's barking or something. I'll say, you better get yourself in here. She knows my voice. She understands my voice. She understands authority in my voice. But there's just something about the mother's touch. There's something about a female touch. Because we just don't have it. Shirley can be riding in the same car that I've been riding the puppy in. She can be sitting over there in the passenger seat, the same puppy that gets up in my lap. She won't have a thing in the world to do with me when mama's there. I know this is a little bit humor, but I'm telling you this morning, there is something God created, something very special and something very extraordinary in the woman. And for the love of Jesus, men, we need to stand up and be men. We need to be protectors of our mothers. We need to be protectors of our daughters. We need to be protectors of our families. We need to stand up in this godless culture and society that we're living in and say, no, no, it's not so. My child is not going to run that avenue. My child has a mother. My child has a good mother that loves him, that loves her, and she's going to touch him with that godless touch.
Yeah.
We have just become so nonchalant and so blasé about it. I read a sermon on the internet the other day about a preacher, and I'm thinking, good Lord, he's going to really tell us something today. As he began to, he was recording and writing as he had written his sermon out, and he was trying to teach the church how to live in this ungodly culture of ours. And you know most of the advice he gave? Just don't talk about it.
Oh my word, what?
Just point them toward Jesus. Listen to me, you're not going to be one without the other. You can't point people toward Jesus without declaring the truth in the ears of peoples, and so they can hear, and it goes into their heart, it gets into their spirit, and they recognize what they must do to become born again believers.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
That's a true story about that puppy.
Yeah.
I even tell her sometimes, maybe I'm you. You made me feel that. But it's because of the mother's touch. It's the mother's touch. Ladies, that's the way God created you. And I know there's some real brawly women. Brawly women and feminine men. See, it doesn't change anything. In the beginning, nothing. Nothing new. Nothing in this generation. No, the violence, the filth, the vulgarity. I've never seen so much hate in my life. Mama said there was never a day and time that Almighty God needed your love and your compassion and your tenderness, and your sweetness, but yet your firmness. It's today.
Amen.
It's this hour that we're living in today. Yes. You can't change this. I know our leader group here, we realize that. But the world is not going to change this. Mm-hmm. Telling a little boy that's born a little boy when he's 9 years old, and maybe he feels like he has some effeminate tendencies, telling him, well, you wait until you're about 13 or 14. You'll know. You'll learn who you are. If you let him wait till he's 13 or 14, you really don't need to wait until he's 9. We need to start them early on in life. Like the Bible said, train a child up in the way it should go. And when it's old, it will not depart from it. I'm here to tell you, my precious wife, wonderful touch that Almighty God gave her. She trained our boys. She prayed for our boys. They may have drifted away from it, but I'm telling you what my precious wife wrote on the table of those boys' heart. This world has not yet been able to erase it. And I'm here to declare you this morning all the goodness, all the loving touches, all the smiles, all the patting of their hand, all the correction, all the bragging, all the clapping of her hands and praising them when they did well. She wrote say, Pastor, we can't afford to lose anymore, but we can't afford to keep gaining people if they're not going to live right and they don't want the gospel. We can't afford to allow anyone to come in here and infiltrate and invade this body with a lot of junk just in the name of God, because we care about people and we love people. Of course we love people. I would love that 9-year-old child too much, that 9-year-old boy too much, to tell him he can wait until he's 12 or 13 to determine whether he wants to be a little girl or a little boy. Service of the Lord. Hannah didn't buy Samuel a new car, gave him a large monthly allowance. When he turned 21, I think it was age, under that dispensation, she gave him to the service of the Lord. Samuel had wanted a child so badly. One day she was in the temple. You know the story you read in 1 Samuel. She was in the chapter 1. She was in the temple. The Bible says she was so stricken with anguish. She wanted a child. She was so desperate, so very desperate to have a child. So she was praying. She was in prayer. And she must have been in such desperation. Her heart must have been so overwhelmed. She must have been so heavy in her spirit because she desired. She was barren. She was barren. She, her husband, Elkanah, could not have children. And she wanted a child. She wanted a son. She wanted a child so bad that she was in the temple praying and crying out to God. To the priest, Eli came in. And he saw Hannah as she was praying. He thought she was drunk. Somebody over the little garage sale yesterday, somebody was inviting me. Some lady come to church here, and she said, "Isn't that where they speak in tongues?" Well, there went that one. See, we don't cease from the truth because of the world.
Amen.
This is truth this morning.
Yes.
And she was in such a desperate frenzy. I mean, she aggressively sought the Lord. The priest walks in and he says to her, "Woman, how dare you come in?" I'm paraphrasing. "How dare you come into this temple under the influence of alcohol? How dare you come in here drunk?" And Hannah was so desperate, she looked at the priest and she said, "Oh, sir, please, please, no. I'm not drunk. I'm desperate." She said, "I'm desperate for a child." She cried out for a child. She pleaded with God for a child. And Eli saw how desperate she was, and he saw that she was not under the influence, and so he blessed her and bid her farewell. 9 months later, she had a child.
Hallelujah.
Praise
God.
I'm God's husband first.
Yes. Glory.
Mothers, there's something so very special about you.
Yes.
Amen.
You can touch God. You can touch God when it seems like nobody else around can touch God. There's something about your voice. Listen to me, mother. I want to bless you this morning. I know I turned on too off with some of this, but come back next time and I'll finish it off. Mother, there's something very special about you. There's something about your touch. There's something about your voice pattern. There's something about when you call your child by name. Even when my mother... And I tell you, my mama, she could really work the old. But when she called my name, when she said, "Bobby," there's something about her. You know what? There's something special that God gives mothers. Well, she just called my name. When she would touch me, she did touch me often without slapping me. 99% of those slaps I deserve. But there's something about the mother's touch. And I know that Carmen was just respecting you and being reverent to you. But Carmen, I heard his best friend, went to high school together, so on, some of their big buddies, and she's ill in a condition hospital the other day. And 10, 15 minutes later, I found Mrs. Carmen walks in, and so we were talking, one word leads to another, and And Carmen looked at me and she said, Pastor, she said, did you know that God is afraid of Thelma? Thelma knows God's not afraid of her. We all know God's not afraid of her. But then she began to get a little more definitive. She said she remembered, I believe it was Larry Joe. Maybe he was ill or something. And the doctor had given him something that didn't set well with him. And the doctor just turned around and walked off. I'm just going to paraphrase, do the best I can. And Thelma was there. And the doctor just kind of walked off and then wasn't definitive, didn't give him a true explanation. And Carmen said, Thelma was right up behind him. He said, wait a minute, doctor. I've got something I want to ask you. Why did you do this? There's something about a mother's voice. There's something about a mother's touch. There's something about a mother's embrace that you just simply cannot find it anywhere else in the world. And the reason you can't find it, because it's not there to be found. It's not lost. The only way you can find something, it has to first be lost. There's something about that mother's touch. Within the character of a godly woman, wind it down. Within the character of a godly woman, you will find a great capacity for physical and spiritual nurture. If a godly mama raised you, if a godly mama raised you, you are indeed blessed.
Amen.
You ought to rejoice all day long today if a godly mother raised you. You have no idea. You have no idea how much she nurtured you. You have no idea how much she sacrificed for you. You have no idea how much time she spent in prayer before God for you. In closing, again, honor your mother today. And remember, it's the first commandment of the cross. That sounds pretty good to me. It's the first commandment with promise that it may be well with you. Isn't that wonderful? Those of you that have honored your mom, even in your most difficult, trying times, even when your mother wasn't that pleasant, have a piece of heaven, you don't know my mom. Well, you didn't know my mom. But the key word is mom. She's your mother.
Amen.
God put something within her no one else has. It's the first commandment of promise that may be well with you, and you may enjoy a long life on the earth. Long life on the earth. I believe with all my heart, when we honor our mothers, we do attract God's favor and God's blessings. Father, I thank you this morning.